drink. Hurry, Mr. Bergeron's on. Don't forget the popcorn, Frank.
Coming, dear.
Got her official spot here. That
go. Good evening, everyone. Welcome. Thank you all for coming. And once again, we have Arthur Bergeron from Merrick O'Connell here to give another presentation. Today, his topic is going to be keeping control as you slow down. I like that.
Yeah, you know that feeling. You know that feeling.
And we welcome Arthur once again, and thank you for coming.
And I just really want to thank Joyce once again. I think Joyce was kind enough to take a chance to start doing these about 6 years ago. This was like a long time ago.
Yeah.
And I think they've been useful for some of your folks, but I think it really shows that what the Senior Center is really feel interested in trying to deal with a whole variety of senior issues. I always hear people who are senior center directors say, you know, this is like beyond bingo, you know, this notion that, right? So I think that's what she's really done, is I think she's really helped a lot of folks. So Joyce, thank you very much. Thank you for the kind introduction. I appreciate it. So, thank you all for coming. My name is Arthur Bergeron. For those of you who don't know me, although I do see some familiar faces, I'm an elder law attorney. I work at Myrick O'Connell. There were about 60 of us at Myrick O'Connell, which gives me the leisure of getting to do just this, because if there are any other problems, I can ask somebody else. So when they have elder law problems, they ask me. So what I decided to do for this year, I do four presentations a year here. And what I decided to do for this year was to start off by doing Elder Law 101 and Elder Law 102. So the first set of questions that you want to ask yourself is, if you are retiring and getting older and you're in that point where you're not earning more money except from your stocks and your bonds and stuff, and what your goal really is to live as well as you can until you die, because as I've often said here, one of the things I like about doing elder law is that my clients realize they're going to die. Their kids don't, right? Your kids are like, oh, you're never going to die. But, you know, you're like, well, no, I get it. You know, I'm going to die. And your goal isn't to not die. I occasionally have a client whose goal in estate planning is to not die. And that's a challenge to try to do their estate plan. But your goal is to live as well as you can until you die, and to keep as much control of your life as you can until you die. And to not waste money. To not let your money drift away to places you really didn't want to leave it to, like the government or the nursing home or whatever. And then following your death to make sure that things get divided up the way you wanted them to be divided up. And that's really a pretty good summary of kind of what elder law is about. So we're going to talk about a variety of those topics. Now, because we're talking about a lot of things, we're not going to talk about any particular thing a lot. And if you have particular questions about a particular thing, I'm glad to talk about it. And then also in the fall, I'll be doing two more focused sessions on topics of particular interest. And so I'm also interested in what you're interested in, because I'm open as to what those topics should be. So, Elder Law 101. Many of you who have been here know my friends Frank and Mary. They're my make-believe couple with their children, Peter, Paul, and Mary Jr. And their goal is very simple. They own a house. They want to live in their house until they die. And they want to be buried in the backyard. And then after they have died, they want to make sure that their kids get what's left. And that's not an uncommon kind of basic plan. They have not a lot of assets. They have a house that's worth $300,000, maybe a little more now. Prices are going back up again. Isn't it wonderful? So the houses' prices are going up. He has an IRA, a small one, $150,000. They have an annuity for $100,000. They have a small bank account, $75,000. So they've got total assets of $625,000. Frank is living on his Social Security check of $1,500 a month and a pension of $5,000. And Mary is getting half of Frank's Social Security at $750. So they're earning, what, $2,750 a month, or, you know, around $30,000 a year. So they're going to be okay. They're not going to be living high, but they're going to be living okay for the rest of their lives. They have some worries about what might happen if one of them needs nursing home care. We're going to talk about that a little bit. And they've got some concerns about what documents they should be dealing with right now. What do they have to be doing right now? Now, typically, what people will tell you is, oh, you have to have a will. So let me talk about that for a sec. Under Massachusetts law, as it's currently written, in the situation that I just described, if Frank dies, everything goes to Mary. Everything that he owns goes to Mary, even if he's not holding it jointly with Mary. That the assets would have to go through, the assets that he holds individually would have to go through the probate process, and he may want to avoid that. But everything is going to go to Mary. And if she is dead, everything is going to be divided equally among the children. So when people say, well, you have to have a will, well, then I'm just saying to you, you want to ask your question, so why exactly do I have to have a will in this situation? The answer may be that you don't. Well, some people will say, well, you know, I really want a will so I can avoid probate. Well, you don't avoid probate by having a will. The probate process is necessary, going to the probate court and talking to a judge about your assets and who gets them, is necessary if you die, because if you die owning something just in your name, not jointly with somebody else, not as a life estate that evaporates when you die, but just in your name, then there needs to be a process to figure out where those things go, who owns them after you're dead. And that's what the probate court is about. Unfortunately, to some extent for your heirs, the probate process is also about making sure all your creditors get paid. So that to the extent that you're concerned that you might have big creditors when you die, that may be a reason that you want to avoid probate entirely. But you don't do that by having a will. So why would you want a will? Well, there are just a couple of reasons. I'm going to go back. So suppose Peter Paul or Mary Jr. Had some issues, right? Suppose one of them had a spouse that things really weren't working out, you know, and you're concerned that, well, you know, you really don't want to leave a lot of money to the daughter-in-law you never liked in the first place, you know? And so what you may want to do in that case, instead of leaving a Peter or Paul's share to Peter or Paul if there are marital problems, is you may want to leave their share in trust for their benefit and name one of the other kids as the trustee. Or if one of them has got serious financial problems, you know, the artist of the family. I shouldn't do that. The person who had a business, you know, who failed or whatever. So that people have got problems, right, coming out of the recession. So you don't want to inadvertently leave what Peter, Paul, or Mary would have gotten to their creditors. That wasn't your goal. So you may want to, in that case, put things in trust for their benefit. And finally, we're going to talk about the situation where if Frank or Mary wants to make sure that if they die, the assets will be protected if their spouse needs nursing home care. In that case, there may want to be a trust. So there may be some reasons to use the will, but don't assume that you need a will. What you do need, what you have to have, are these three things. You have to have a health care proxy. And you need to do a MOLST form. Anybody, how many people here have heard of the MOLST form? Raise your hand. Oh yeah, well, so we're going to talk about that a little bit. And then you need to do a power of attorney. And the reason for that is these are all documents. If your goal is to keep control of your life while you're alive, right? Or if you are incapacitated to make sure that the way you get treated is the way you want it to be treated, then you need these documents. You need a healthcare proxy because the proxy is the person who makes all medical decisions regarding your treatment if you are incapacitated. If you're incapacitated temporarily because you're in a coma or you're having the operation or something, or if you're incapacitated permanently, if your doctor determines that because you have dementia that's serious enough that you really can't make medical decisions, your healthcare proxy automatically kicks in. By the way, this question comes up quite a bit because, once again, I do nothing but elder law. So most of my clients are clients who are either worried about Alzheimer's or have Alzheimer's or who have a relative who has Alzheimer's. So these kinds of issues come up. If a doctor has declared that you're capable of making a medical decision, well, having yourself admitted to a nursing home is a medical decision, right? Therefore, the proxy can make that decision for you, except that you can always object. So if you go to the nursing home with your son, who's trying to dump you there, and I shouldn't put it that way, but if he wants you to be in the nursing home and you don't, and you say, I don't want to be here, well, that has the effect of revoking the proxy. And you can't be forced to stay there unless somebody gets a court order. Right? So you just kind of want to be aware of that, both if you're trying to protect yourself because you want to be able to say that, or if you're worried about that relative of yours who now has Alzheimer's and you're saying, well, what do I do if he or she doesn't want to go to the nursing home? The answer is, if they really don't want to go, you're going to need to get a court order, no matter what, no matter what. Finally, revocation. Healthcare proxies are automatically revoked by the signing of another healthcare proxy. And the reason why you want to remember that is if you've done one and you feel that the proxy really covers the issues that you want to cover regarding giving your proxy the flexibility to deal with your issues. And then you go to the hospital, you know, and they always give you that form to sign. You're in the emergency rooms, just sign here. It's the proxy form, which they want to make sure they have in case you go under it while you're in the hospital. They want to know who to call. Well, by signing their form, you've revoked the old proxy. So what you want to do instead, once you have a proxy, is bring it to your doctor. Bring a copy to your doctor and your primary care physician. Your doctor, and then, when you go to the hospital, will send them a copy, will fax them or email them a copy of the healthcare proxy. And then if you want, they really want you to bring it with you, you can. A couple of other things regarding healthcare proxy, and I spent some time on this just because, I mean, lawyers don't talk about this a lot, I think because they're so inexpensive, and you know, lawyers like to talk about more expensive things, but these are the really important things, right? So the question is, who should be your proxy? Now, every time I have a husband and wife coming in talking about these issues, they assume that if one of them is incapacitated, the other one should be the proxy. And that may be perfectly appropriate. But I want to mention to you, as you get older, you're with your spouse and you're really close, but if your spouse needs to be in the hospital, what do you really want to be doing? Do you want to be next to your spouse? Or do you want to be trying to figure out what in the world the medical record is saying and talking to the doctors and the physicians and everybody else, right? If your decision is the former, that you just, and if you have, if Peter Paul or Mary Jr. is your designated child, I always refer to him typically as the designated daughter. Typically, most families, there's somebody who is kind of the one you kind of count on, right? Now, many families, there are many. Most families, there's one. And usually, it's the daughter. So if there is one, what you may want to do as you get older is say, well, I'm going to name my daughter as the primary proxy, because I know she's going to talk to my spouse if I get sick, you know, and that way I don't have to think about it, right? I can just be with my spouse. So I just mentioned that. Finally, there is a lot of discussion about whether to put your wishes regarding how you want to be treated in your healthcare proxy. I am increasingly thinking that the better way to handle this, and we're having a lot of discussion about this in the office, is to actually do that in a separate document. The reason is that any of those instructions that you give to the proxy, I don't want to be, you know, the standard line I hear from my clients, I don't want to be a vegetable. If I'm going to be a vegetable, I'd rather be dead, right? And so if I'm going to be in a vegetative state, I don't want any extreme measures to be taken. But then questions start coming up, like what exactly is a vegetative state and what exactly are the extreme measures that you don't want to have taken? Do you not want to have intravenous feeding? You know, do you not want to have any liquids given to you? You know, what does all of that mean? So my advice to people is moving towards saying have a separate document. Do a writing to your proxy. Dear daughter, dear Mary, here are my feelings about how I want to be treated if I'm in this kind of condition, right? That way you're not going to confuse the doctor or anybody else whom you're handing this proxy to with any of this extra language, because it's irrelevant anyway, since none of it's binding. Your proxy has total control over any of those medical decisions once your doctor has said that you're incapable of making the medical decision. So if, for example, you have a DNR, a so-called do not resuscitate order or a comfort care order, but your proxy is there when you're on the floor and the EMT is deciding whether to resuscitate you, the proxy can say, no, I don't want to resuscitate it, and that's it. Or no, or I do want to resuscitate it, and that's it, right? Proxy's where it goes. Speaking of these kinds of instructions, there is often some standard language in a healthcare proxy that says, not only do I want to be, you know, do I want no excessive measures if I'm in a vegetative state, but also if I cannot recognize people or engage in a real, in a conversation, in a rational way, right? In other words, if I've got dementia, right? Now, I do a lot of work with folks who have dementia. I think that you can live a happy and fulfilling life for a long time after you have dementia, even if the dementia is fairly severe. It isn't a happy and fulfilling life if the people around you aren't treating you well, if they don't understand. There's a term called learning how to speak Alzheimer's. It's a wonderful book about it. If you don't understand the conversations and focusing on the present and dealing with those. But in general, I think you can live a happy life. So your question, because it's your body, right, is how much instruction you want to give to your proxy regarding not having you treated for medical problems merely because you have memory loss, right, or can't recognize folks. You want to think about that. And then in that other statement of wishes, that kind of separate statement, you want to talk about some issues that don't have to do with your health. You know, do you want somebody to call a priest or a rabbi or a minister? What other things do you want to have done, right? So you want to kind of think about that cluster of things. Now that is, those are important documents. A couple of other quick things. Organ donations. Interestingly enough, a few years ago, the organ donation statute was changed. Until then, in order for you to be asked, or for someone to be asked about the donation of your organs or tissues or whatever after you die, you would have to have signed up for that with something called the New England Organ Bank, which is a New England-wide place where organs get donated, a real place. It's in Waltham, Mass. Or you know, done it through when you got your license. You can do it through getting your license and stuff. Well, a couple of years ago, apparently because there weren't enough things being donated, that law got changed. And at this point, when you die, it is presumed that you're okay with having parts of your body donated. And if you die in a hospital or a nursing home, many other settings, your body cannot be released to the funeral home or to anybody until the permission is given from the organ bank, right? Now, this leads to the question, well, what if you don't want your body to be donated? What if, for religious reasons, I'm told that among Greek Orthodox folks, among conservative Jewish folks, there are real issues about the donation of body parts. What can you do? Is there a form you can sign to have you make sure your body does not get donated? And the answer is no. No. I actually contacted the New England Organ Bank to ask that question. They said no. The other interesting thing about this is that the new law, when they were dealing with this issue, also said that the person who is in charge of your remains for purposes of the organ donation law is the healthcare proxy. Unbelievable. So actually, the healthcare proxy does not die when you do. They continue to have a role in terms of seeing if your body is going to be donated. So the right place to put that information, if you don't want your body to be donated, is probably in your healthcare proxy. You probably want to make a statement that specifically says that it's your intention that no parts of your body be donated. By the way, the law says that the healthcare proxy is the first person in charge. After that is your personal representative, used to be called the executor. And if you don't have a will, then it's your next of kin. Now, the MOLST form, M-O-L-S-T, Medical Orders for Life-Sustaining Treatment. That form is replacing the DNR, or the so-called Comfort Care form. The Department of Health is trying very hard to have doctors and others encourage or talk to you about signing a MOLST form. Did I tell you, by the way, to shut off your phone so that we wouldn't be interrupted during this presentation? Excuse me. Why does this happen to me? I don't know why. Wait a minute. I have to kill this now. Is that bad or what? Can we cut that out of the tape? No, it's probably gonna stay in the tape. So the MOLST form. The most form is designed to try to broaden what people were trying to deal with the DNR, with the Do Not Resuscitate form. And so it involves a set of instructions that your doctor can give. And the key to the most form, like the DNR, is that it's not really an instruction by you to somebody saying, don't resuscitate me, or don't do this. It's really an instruction from your doctor. Your doctor has to sign that form. You assent to it, because your doctor doesn't want to sign the form unless you've assented to it. But it is really an instruction from the doctor to the medics that show up at your door in the ambulance, right? And to the nurses at the hospital, to all these other people in the medical chain of command that says, as a medical order, don't do this or don't do that. So the doctor's signature is going to be necessary. The place to put the MOLST form is on your refrigerator. Why is that? Because when the ambulance people are trained as to what to do if they show up at your house, because you're on the ground, and what they're told to do is go look at the refrigerator. Actually, they're told that, at least all the ones that I've talked to, and see if there's a form to check to see if there's any of this kind of information. And if there's not, they stop looking, you know, because they're busy. You know, they've gotten their urine on the floor. They've got to do something. So they're going to check the refrigerator, and that's it. So if this is a concern to you, that's where you put it. And remember that no matter what you put in the MOLST form, your healthcare proxy can overrule it. Decisions in the MOLST form, there is certainly the basic CPR decision, cardiopulmonary resuscitation. What is that? That is causing your heart to start beating when it has stopped. How do you do that? You do that by putting a lot of compression, probably breaking through your ribs if you're an older person, so that your heart, they can push on your heart and just literally start pushing on your heart to see if it can get going again. I recently talked to a geriatrician who told me that for people over 75, that the percentage of people over 75 who get administered CPR, the percent who survive more than 30 days is under 20%. And the reason why I mention that is because this is a very, very painful process, CPR, especially with older folks. So you may want to think out ahead of time whether you really want that. Or intubation. What is intubation? Intubation is causing your lungs to start breathing again when they've stopped. And the way that you do that is you put a tube down your throat and into the lungs, and then you start pushing air into the lungs to see if you can get your lungs going. Also, like, not a pleasant thing, right? So one of the options in the MOLST form is to say that, you know, I don't want CPR, I don't want intubation. There are other options, but I just want to mention one other one, and that is do not hospitalize. Do not hospitalize. The reason why I say that is, if your goal, like Frank and Mary, is to die at home, you don't really want to die in the hospital, you know? You want to die a natural death. If your goal is to die at home, you don't want to go to the hospital. Right? And if your goal is to die if your heart stops or whatever, you don't want to go to the hospital. Because when you go to the hospital, they're going to do everything they can to save you. Because that's what doctors are trained to do, right? And that's what doctors really have a lot of trouble with a lot of this stuff, with dealing with procedures for letting you die. And because the hospital doesn't want you to die. For many years, I was on the board of trustees of our local hospital. And I remember going to these board meetings, and one of the statistics we looked at every month was the mortality in the hospital. We don't want a lot of mortality in our hospital. No, we got to report that to DPH. There are too many people die at our hospital. We get investigated. We get all this stuff. We want to get you home. We want to make you come back and get you home, right? So if you don't want those kinds of extraordinary measures, maybe you want to say, and you can now, in the MOLST form, say, I don't want to go to the hospital. I want to stay here. So, and why do you want to do this? If the alternative to having a healthcare proxy is, if you're incapacitated and somebody needs to make medical decisions for you, is a guardianship, which under the new guardianship law, which changed also a few years ago, is going to cost you at least $10,000. It's going to inevitably causes family fighting. I see this all the time because people have different opinions as to how mom or dad should be treated. And it's a very public process. That goes through the probate process. Your power of attorney. What about your power of attorney? Does a power of attorney is a document that gives someone else the power to do make all legal decisions that you could make unless you've limited their power of attorney somehow, in addition to you. So by signing a power of attorney, you're not giving up your power to make those decisions. You're just saying that in addition to you, somebody else can make those decisions for you. Does a power of attorney need to be notarized? No. Does it need to be witnessed? No. The only time it needs to be notarized is if you're giving your attorney the power to sign documents that get recorded in the registry of deeds. Deeds, mortgages, stuff like that. Now, should you have them notarized? Probably. The reason is simple. You've heard me use this, some of you have been here, heard me use this line before. My daughter once gave me a wonderful t-shirt that said, "The good lawyer knows the law, the great lawyer knows the judge." Now, in the case of powers of attorney, the judge isn't a real judge, right? Who's looking at this power of attorney to decide whether it's valid? It's the bank teller, right? When your son goes in to sign one of your checks and says, "Oh, Dad's really sick," so, you know, you hand him this proxy and he looks at it and he goes, "Well, I don't know if this is valid, you know? How can I tell that this is a valid or is a valid power of attorney?" Amazingly, if a document is notarized, everybody thinks it's really official. Right? So the only real reason to notarize it, except in the real estate case, is to make it look official for folks like that. In the power of attorney, if you want to give your attorney, who is often your spouse or one of your children, the power to make gifts to anybody, and specifically to make gifts to themselves, you have to specify that in the power of attorney, otherwise they can't. And if you have And as opposed to the healthcare proxy, where you can only name one person at a time to be the proxy, with a power of attorney, you can name as many people as you want, and you can also name them jointly and severally. So, for example, in this case, Mary or Frank and Mary could name each other and could also name the designated kid, maybe Mary Jr., jointly and severally, so that if one of them is incapacitated and the other spouse doesn't want to deal with it, the daughter can deal with it, without having to prove that Mary is all that the other spouse has also become incapacitated. So it's a very important document. And by the way, how often should these be reviewed? My recommendation is once every 5 years, for the reason that I suggested before. You don't want to be going to ask somebody to accept this document if it's really old looking, because someone's just going to say, "Well, I don't know if that's valid." And you know, what are you going to say at that point? You know, you're going to sue them, right? So you want to try to keep those documents fresh. Same, the power of attorney, just like the healthcare proxy. The alternative, I had this happen actually often, that somebody is going, typically when somebody is trying to do, is in crisis, there's somebody going to the nursing home, we're trying to restructure some assets so that we can qualify for mass health, and so we have to do some asset transferring, and no one has a power of attorney to deal with things on behalf of the incapacitated person. And the answer is, you have to get a guardianship. You have to get the probate court to approve a guardianship. $10,000, could be fighting, it's awful. It's a complete waste, and you can solve all these problems by simply having a power of attorney. So, those are the really important documents. Now, a little bit about asset protection. One of the most common things that I hear from folks who are first talking to me about kind of planning ahead is they get nervous about nursing home care. They've listened to the radio, they've been told that they have to transfer all of their assets out of their name, put it in an irrevocable trust, and wait 5 years. Now, I'm sorry if for some of the folks who have been here before I'm boring you, because you know that that's not the case. So we're going to talk about that just a little bit. MassHealth 101. MassHealth is the entity, it's the Massachusetts name for Medicaid, that pays for nursing home care. Medicare, which many of you have, I bet, because you're eligible for it if you're over 65. Raise your hand if you're over 65. Look at that, a lot of people. So Medicare is health insurance for the old. I just signed up, actually. I was 65 2 months ago. Medicaid, therefore MassHealth, is health insurance for the poor. To demonstrate that you qualify for Medicaid, you need to show that you are poor. Frank and Mary don't look poor. Right? They've got quite a bit in assets. So the question is, what if Mary needs to go to a nursing home? And they're Frank and Mary have just the assets that you just saw. How many of you think that Frank's going to have to spend down quite a bit of these assets in order to keep Mary in the nursing home? Because, of course, Medicare doesn't cover nursing home care beyond the first 100 days. How many of you think Frank's going to have to spend quite a bit here? Anybody? A few people? You're wrong. Now, the reason for that is that for Mary to qualify for MassHealth while she's in the nursing home, she has to show that she is poor. She has to show that she has less than $2,000 in countable assets. Frank, though, because he's at home, can actually have the home itself, as long as it has equity of less than $800, it just went up, it used to be $814,000, can have cash or cash equivalent assets, and this number just went up a little bit too, of $119,220. And in addition to that, can have infinite income. Now you saw that Frank's income was about $2,000 a month, Mary's income is $750 a month. Once Mary qualifies for MassHealth, her income will go to the nursing home, MassHealth will pay all the rest. Frank, though, he can have that income and then some. So what Frank would need to do in this case, if Mary were in the nursing home, and this can be done right before she qualifies for MassHealth. There is no look-back period regarding transfers between spouses. As long as somebody has a power of attorney to sign things on Mary's behalf, Mary could transfer the house to Frank, because remember they owned it jointly. She could transfer all the other assets to Frank. Frank could then buy an annuity with all the assets that are over, that would put him over $119,220. As long as that annuity has certain characteristics, as long as it calls for equal monthly payments over a term that is shorter than Frank's actuarial life expectancy, and by the way, Frank is about 80 right now, his life expectancy is about 8 years. As long as it has those characteristics, the purchase of the annuity is a legitimate spend down of his assets. And once he's bought the annuity and gotten his assets below $119,220, Mary can immediately qualify for MassHealth. Because there's no look back regarding the transfers to Frank, and there's no look back regarding his purchase of this annuity. So she can transfer in day one, he can buy the annuity in day two, she qualifies for MassHealth in day three. So if Frank and Mary are both alive, there's no reason now why they have to do anything about impoverishing themselves or transferring assets out of their name and waiting 5 years. They don't have to do any of that, right? The only problem that Frank and Mary would face would be, what if Frank dies? If Frank dies, remember we went through the list of assets and the house was owned jointly, and the other stuff was owned jointly. And even if everything has been transferred to Frank, if Frank doesn't have a will, or has a will, the standard I love you will, that says I'm leaving everything to my spouse, then Mary's going to have a problem. Because Mary's going to have way too much in assets. She's going to have to spend down everything but the house to less than $2,000. She'll then qualify for MassHealth, but at that point, MassHealth will put a lien on that house to make sure that MassHealth gets reimbursed after Mary's death. The way that you deal with that, the way that Frank and Mary can deal with that, and they can deal with it now, right? But they don't have to deal with it now. They can actually deal with it later, right? We have Frank and Mary both change their wills to say, when I die, everything that would have gone to my spouse, instead I want to have go in trust for the benefit of my spouse. I'm going to name one of my kids, or all of my kids, Peter, Paul, and Mary Jr. as the trustees. I'm going to give them discretion to use as much of that money as they want on behalf of my spouse. If you structure things that way, if Frank structures things that way and owns all the assets, and upon his death Mary is in the nursing home, all the assets are immediately safe and Mary simply stays on MassHealth. If he did it ahead of time, if he died and then Mary later went in the nursing home, none of those assets would have been countable and Mary could qualify for MassHealth. So there is a clear, so that's kind of my recommendation typically to Frank and Mary. Sometimes makes sense to try to do this ahead of time so you're not worrying about it if Mary gets a stroke and then goes into the nursing home and now you're trying to shuffle around, or there's a car accident, Frank can't sign stuff. So you may want to do it ahead, but you don't have to. The other thing, though, that's really necessary to this plan is the power of attorney, right? Someone needs that power of attorney from Mary so that they can, on Mary's behalf, shift the assets to Frank. Or if Frank has gone to the nursing home, shift the assets to Mary. So the power of attorney is really, really important. We talked about early asset shift, or we didn't talk about early asset shifting. Some folks, this often is the case when I'm talking to folks, and one of the spouses has a serious heart problem, so that he has a really high likelihood or a greater likelihood of just dropping dead before you can do any of this kind of shifting around. In that case, oftentimes people will do this plan and then stack all of the assets in the name of that person. Or if there are spouses that have a significant age difference, so that it's much more likely that one spouse versus the other will die first, then we typically stack the assets in the name of that spouse. But you don't have to. You can wait till the last minute. We've literally done this asset shifting the day before somebody dies. You know, I had a couple that came in. Classic, wife had cancer, husband had early stage dementia, wife is crying, what do I do? Well, it's pretty much Frank and Mary. I own a house, I've got some cash, you know, I'm gonna die. She knew she was gonna die in a couple of months. My husband's gonna be stuck in the nursing home, all the money's gonna get spent. And they said, no, this is very simple. We're gonna change your will so that you say upon your death, everything's gonna go in trust for your spouse. We're gonna shift all the assets to you, and then you can die in peace. And that's what we did. And she died 2 months later, and the husband went into the nursing home about a month after that because she'd really been caring for him at home. And that was sad because he was now needed to be in the nursing home because there weren't enough supports. But at least the $700,000 didn't end up paying for the nursing home for the next 5 years because nursing home costs is about $150,000 a year. So, you know, this is kind of a sensible thing to do. What about if they haven't done any of that, though, and Frank has died? And now Mary comes into my office and says, whoa, what do I do? And now that's her asset. She owns everything now just in her name. What is she going to do? Well, in order for her to protect any of these assets now, she does have to give them away and wait 5 years. Now, she doesn't have to give them away into a trust and wait 5 years. She can just give them away. She can give them away to Peter, Paul, or Mary Jr., right? That might make her very nervous. And so what she might want to do is give the house away but keep a life estate in the house. That is, the right to live in the house for the rest of her life. If she does that, then give Mary or the kids the so-called remainder interest in the house. That is, the ownership in the house after the mother is dead. If she does that, then 5 years go by and she needs to qualify for MassHealth, the house is effectively safe. Because while MassHealth, if she qualifies, once she's gotten rid of her cash, of course. So, because if she qualifies for MassHealth, MassHealth will put a lien on her life estate. But at her death, her life estate, and therefore the lien, will evaporate, and the house will be free and clear to the kids. There are a couple of reasons to not do that. If Mary does that and transfers to the kids and keeps the life estate, and then wants to sell the house, because she doesn't need the nursing home care over the next 5 years. But she wants to sell the house because she wants to move to assisted living or she wants to do something else. In that case, she's going to owe a capital gains tax on a part of the value of the house. So if there's a real serious interest in selling the house, then she may not want that alternative. The alternative she may want may be then to create an irrevocable trust, a trust that she can't get the property back from, a trust that does not name her as a beneficiary, except to a very limited extent, but make sure that the characteristics of that trust for tax purposes are such that she still owns the property. You have to trust me; that can be done. That's very often done. But so, and we're going to take all questions at the end. There may be cases where she wants to use this irrevocable trust, but it's very, very limited. What about the rest? What about giving away the cash that she has? Well, she could. Does she want to put it into an irrevocable trust? No. What she wants to do in that case is she needs to transfer the money to one or more of the kids, then have them create a trust themselves to hold the money in one place, typically naming themselves as beneficiaries, with the distribution of that money to happen after Mary dies. But with some kind of provision so that if Mary then gets sick or just needs some money, the kids can distribute the money to themselves and then turn around and give it back to mom. That's getting complicated. I'll be glad to talk about that more and may talk about it more in the fall. But I guess the main thing to know is the gifting doesn't have to be to an irrevocable trust, right? The nature of the gifting may end up being different for different kinds of assets. But if you're just married, if you're single, you have to go through this huge exercise. Or alternatively, get married again. get married again, you get taken care of all these problems, right? Then we can just give it all to your new husband, right? If you get to, actually, I had this. I had a person who was divorced from his first wife, been living with this woman for like 20 years, and was very concerned because he was getting early stage dementia, right? It was like, what do I do? What do I do? And he had like $3 million. He had a wonderful big house and quite a bit of cash. And I said, it's time to get married. Oh, well, you know, we don't want to for, I said, no problem. No, you can decide. You know, you can not get married and give the money to the nursing home, or you can get married and give the money to the person you love. You know, it's your choice, right? He did it. They got married. It was very romantic. So, we talked about that, so I'm going to skip that. We talked about that. Oh, yeah, the other thing about, I am going to mention that, though. The other advantage of giving the property, though, to the trustee of an irrevocable trust. Say you've got these three kids. I'm going to give you a different example. I got a call today, actually, from a woman who has an interest in one of the houses in the campground. She and her two siblings, and because they inherited it, because their mother gave them the cottage, right? And so they all own it, which means they all own it. They all, and if there are any decisions that have to be made regarding that cottage, they all have to agree. And if there's a dispute, there's no way of figuring it out. Right? There's just, everybody has to agree to everything. Unless somebody decides to go to court and file a petition to have the property sold, which is the exact thing that the grandmother never wanted to have happen, was to have that happen. So if you are in Martha's Vineyard, and you're trying to deal with that property, and you know, Martha's Vineyard is different from the rest of the world. I you know that, like in a lot of ways. But one of the ways is, in most of the rest of the world, when you die, right, it is assumed that your property will be sold and the money will be added to the pot and you'll divide it up among your kids, right? In Martha's Vineyard, I find that's like less than 50% of the time that that's the case. Everybody wants to save the house, right? Because everybody's used to coming to the house, right? So if you want that to happen, then you may want to create a trust. Figure out the mechanism through which the house is going to keep staying in the family and who's going to get to use it when and how all of that's going to get figured out, right? And you may be doing your, so while you're doing this stuff in order to deal with this other issue of how to make sure that the nursing home, that you don't end up having to sell the house or having to sell the house and pay MassHealth all of the money. In the course of that, you may end up having that other conversation. Long-term care insurance. In the course of, it, inevitably, when I'm talking to folks, once again, they're late 60s, early 70s, that kind of area, they're saying, so either they already own long-term care insurance, but they're getting this huge premium bill, and they're like, do I have to keep paying? You know, what is this? And it keeps going up. Or they're thinking about long-term care insurance, and the question is, do they need it? Well, I wanted to do this after I did all the other stuff, because clearly, if you're Frank and Mary, you don't need it, right? Because you've got a mechanism through which if one of you needs nursing home care, you're going to shift everything to the other, and through which you can protect your spouse if you die because all the assets are going to be in trust for the benefit of the other. So you don't need long-term care insurance to pay for your nursing home care. And most of the sales of long-term care insurance have been about that, right? The question though is, why would you then buy long-term care insurance? Well, if you're just married and Frank is dead, if you're divorced or widowed, you may want long-term care insurance if you are uncomfortable, if you really want your assets protected, and if you're uncomfortable with the notion of giving them away, right, of losing control over them, right, because the long-term care insurance, let me step back. Everybody knows the five-year look-back period, right, and oh, it's terrible that, you know, if you give something away, you have to wait 5 years and all that. Well, the flip side of that, though, right, is that as a planning matter, if you have more than the amount that it's going to cost to get you through the nursing home for 5 years, all of the extra is safe. So if you, in Frank and Mary's case, none of it is safe because nursing home care costs about $150,000 a year here on the island. So that's $750,000, and they have less than that, right? They have some income which would pay the nursing home, but still, they burn through all their money in the 5 years. What if, though, you had a long-term care insurance policy that was going to cover a significant piece of that bill? That bill, which is about $400 a day, which is about $12,000 a month, which is $144,000 a year. That's why it costs about $150,000. If you had a long-term care insurance policy that was filling in a lot of that hole, and it was going to cover $300,000 or $400,000 or $500,000 worth of long-term care during that five-year period, then you would have actually saved something for your kids by doing that, right? But that's once again, you only need to do that if you're widowed or divorced, not if you're frank and married. What you may want it for, though, is for this other program. If there is a program in Massachusetts, this isn't true in all states, which parallels the long-term care, the MassHealth long-term care program, and it's called the Frail Elder Waiver. If in the opinion of the people at Elder Services of Cape Cod and the Islands, which for various reasons they're the ones that make the decision, if they decide that you, that if they've evaluated you at home, and they find that you need assistance with at least two of the activities of daily living, and the activities of daily living, there are five of them. They are dressing, eating, bathing, toileting, and transferring. Transferring means getting up and getting across the room and sitting down. If you need physical assistance with at least two of those, or if you simply need constant supervision because otherwise you're a danger to yourself, because you might walk out into the ocean and just drown, you know, then you are medically eligible for nursing home care in the Commonwealth and for receiving MassHealth nursing home benefits. Once that's the case, you are also eligible for a program called the Frail Elder Waiver, through which MassHealth will pay for all of the home care hours that are necessary in order to keep you at home, right? Up to, not all, but up to 40, 50, 60 hours a week, a lot of home care hours. Now, there are some controls on that, though. One is there is an asset limit, right? You have to have less than $2,000 in countable assets, right? And that's pretty low, right? But Frank and Mary could deal with that, or if Frank were dead, Mary could deal with that, which through something called the D4C pool trust, which I won't go into, but she could. But there's also an income limit. You cannot qualify for that program without paying a huge deductible, unless if you make more than $2,199 per month. Now, in Frank and Mary's case, that wouldn't be a problem because each of them makes less than that amount. But if you are in the situation, and I know this is true for many retirees who are getting a pension plus Social Security, or they had very big government pensions or whatever, that they would actually have income that's higher than that. In that case, you will never get significant home care to help you stay at home and out of the nursing home. So ironically, the purpose of the long-term care insurance policy is really about not covering your nursing home care, but helping you stay at home by covering your home care. And in that context, if you are thinking about a long-term care insurance policy, you may want to be thinking about what the policy says about whom you can hire in that situation, about what the definition of sick is in that policy, because that varies all across the board. How sick do you have to be to get the care? Whether you can only hire from certified agencies, whether you can only hire from their certified agencies. That's your classic insurance company, look at the fine print, right? And whether you're allowed to make extra payments. The question is, and I know it's really a problem here on Martha's Vineyard, that during the summer, home care people cost a lot of money because people can make better money cleaning houses, right, for all the summer people who are here. So in order to keep the home care people, you really need to be able to kind of top off the amount that would be being paid by somebody else. So you want to be kind of thinking about those issues if you're thinking about buying long-term care insurance. You don't need it if you're Frank and Mary and you're both alive and you've got their incomes. But there are some situations where you might want it and you want to talk that through with somebody. A couple of other things. Estate tax avoidance. Very briefly. If you have an estate that is worth more than $1 million and you're not leaving it all to your spouse, because there's 100% spousal deduction or marital deduction, you're going to pay an estate tax in Massachusetts. Sometimes in Martha's Vineyard, you do have to pay a federal estate tax because there are people, especially because of their real estate, that have that much money. But the federal estate tax doesn't kick in until you're making well over $5 million. And if there's two of you, you and your spouse, that's really over $10 million. But be aware, in Massachusetts, if Frank had died and left everything to Mary, and Mary then died and all of her assets put together, minus the expenses of her estate, were more than $1 million, the tax rate on that first dollar over $1 million is 40%. And yeah, grown, and it stays 40%, not for long. It stays 40% actually on only the first $100,000. And then for a bizarre reason that I won't go through, it drops to like 6 or 7%. But the main thing is, if you're just a little bit over, you get killed. On that first $100,000, basically, you're paying about $40,000 in tax. If you think that may be your situation, you can, through simply putting some provisions in your wills or trusts, avoid the tax. If you're Frank and Mary, so you have two spouses that are still alive. And I'm not going to go through how to do that. You've probably all heard it before, so through so-called A-B trusts. I'm not going to go through it. But the point is, you can do that. And you can combine the provisions of the trust that you would use in order to do that can be combined with the provisions that you would use for the asset protection that we were talking about earlier, the Frank and Mary asset protection. So just be aware of that. Avoiding probate. So we talked about probate already, right? And as I said, if you don't have, whether you have a will or not is completely irrelevant as to whether or not you're going to be going through the probate process. The question is, do you die owning any assets that are just in your name? If you want to avoid probate, then the way to do it, there are several ways to do it. One, which is very popular, is joint ownership. That's how most of you are probably doing it right now. You've owned most of your things. Husband and wife as tenants by the entirety. You own your house that way. You have your accounts in joint names. Legally, by the way, I'm really sorry. I see people that the sun is right in your eyes. I don't think I can avoid that, though. I don't think I can. Sorry about that. We'll take care of that next time because it'll be a different season. Right? Oh! See now that's lack of technological awareness. This is why we went to law school, you know, because we couldn't do these things. We didn't know how to do these things. So you can have things that are in joint ownership, right? So if one person dies, and the way joint ownership works is that each person who is a joint owner is an owner of 100% of that thing. You don't own a piece of it. And so when the first person dies, that person's interest legally evaporates, and the other person owns all 100%. Presumptively. That presumption, however, can be rebutted. The most common family feud is the feud between the surviving joint owner of a bank account or a house or whatever, and the personal representative of the estate who said, you know, Ma didn't mean that you have that bank account. She had just put your name on it for convenience because she was getting old and she wanted to make sure that somebody was taking care of the money, right? Or you really leaned on Ma when she was done, you know, how come she transferred it to you, right? That's not what the will says, blah, blah, blah. You know, you've all heard those stories, right? Now, the way to deal with that, ironically, is to have a will. And in your will, say what your intention was regarding the property that was held jointly when you died. Ironically, by putting that provision in the will, you are probably making sure that the will never be probated, because you're clearing up the issue in terms of anybody else who thinks they've been cheated. Or alternatively, if you do have a child that's on one of your joint bank accounts or on anything else as a convenience to you, but you think that that property is going to get divided up when you die, you may want to have a will that says that, right? So that if you die and the child becomes the owner of the house because they're the joint owner, they really do end up selling it and splitting it, right? You'll never have a probate because that person will know that if they don't sell it and split it, there's going to be a probate because the will says it's supposed to be sold and split, right? So you may want to have a will, even though that will is not going to get probated for those reasons. Revocable trusts are often used for this purpose also. For people who are not worried about other issues like the estate tax or specifically who are not worried about the asset protection, you can put your house into a trust, name yourself as the trustee, keep complete control over it. But say that upon your death, one of your kids is going to be the trustee. Your child can then immediately sell the house and distribute the proceeds. There are probate avoidance advantages of that. Finally, personal property. What about tangible personal property? What's that? That's all the stuff that's not the house, The house is real property. Your bank, all that's your bank accounts, your stock, that's all intangible personal property. Everything else is tangible personal property. The answer to me, the answer is, simply do a list, right? Just do a list of who of you want to have receive whatever, right? And by the way, if you do that, or saying that regarding that property that you want it to be divided equally among the kids or whatever, and just have that list available, right? Once again, you may want to have a will that simply refers to that list. But it has been my experience, I've been practicing like forever, like 40 years. Wow, and I've never had a dispute go to probate court regarding fighting about the tangible personal property, right? So to have to feel that you have to have a will just in order to deal with the tangible personal property, no. And if you die and all the bank accounts are in joint names or whatever, and all that's left is the tangible personal property, there's never going to be a probate. There's never, because the kids are just going to divide it up, except for the car or the boat. The car or the boat. Because the car and the boat, they both have titles to them. And therefore, there is a government process for demonstrating who owns a property where there's a title to it. And unfortunately, those items are going to have to go through probate. But in the case of the car, that's going to be a very inexpensive probate, because if your total assets that are going through probate, not counting the car, are less than $25,000, there's this like one-page form that you fill out, gets approved right away, your total legal costs are under $1,000, it's very, very quick. So, that's avoiding probate. We talked about those two issues. The reason why you may want to have a will, even though it really doesn't do anything in terms of the distributions because you've got everything in joint names or whatever, is to say where the personal property is going to be going, even though you're never going to probate the will, but this way you have an official instruction as to where it goes, and to say officially what's supposed to happen to those joint accounts. Finally, if you want to see this again or any of the presentations that I do, you don't have to come to one of these again, right? You can go on YouTube. We have our YouTube channel. Elder Law, Frank and Mary have their own channel. And the goal of all of this is to sleep well at night. So if any of this has helped you by clarifying any of this, great. If it's made you more disturbed, I feel really bad about that. But go talk to your lawyer and straighten it up. Thank you. Any questions? Any questions? Yes, sir.
Yeah, you were talking about the life estate.
Yep.
And, here we go. Mary's asset protection plan, and there was the life estate that had been created by Mary, and the ownership of the property, real estate, had already gone to the children. Well, couldn't she just gift the life estate to the children to avoid that issue?
So the question is, why wouldn't Mary, in that case, instead of keeping a life estate and gifting the remainder to the children,
right,
just gift the whole thing to the children, right?
Right.
There are a couple of reasons for that. One, remember now, she's doing this, she's not in the nursing home when she's doing this, right? She's doing this way ahead of time, because if she's single, she has to do this 5 years before she goes to qualify for MassHealth. So at that point, she's not thinking she's going to the nursing home. And what she may be worried about is, she's inevitably heard that story about the rat kid that threw the parent out, you know, because they became the owner of the house.
I'm saying, 5 years. She knows she's going to the nursing home next month.
Well, then, this
and now, but the value of the real estate is not in the life estate, it's in the actual ownership of the real estate. The value, I mean, I'm a real estate broker, and I've been in these situations where we're trying to determine what is the value of a life estate. It's not a huge amount of money, even for a valuable piece of real estate here in Martha's Vineyard.
Right.
So I'm saying, why doesn't Mary at that point just say, okay, the value of the life estate is $60,000, $80,000, $110,000, and if there's some tax or something that has to be paid on that, then okay, let's do that and get rid of the life estate, and the kids now move on with the house, and she deals with that 110 or whatever that number comes to with the nursing home.
No, but see, the problem is it isn't 110 when it comes to the nursing home at this point. It's she has to spend it all down. If she's single at that point, if she's widowed, right, and she is gifted anything within 5 years of the date that she's trying to qualify for MassHealth, 100% of the things that she has gifted are countable as still being assets of her, right? And
real estate.
And now
the kids
she's giving away the life.
They've given her the life estate. She doesn't own the property. She's just there until she dies. Okay, so she sells the life estate to the kids.
So two issues. One, you are correct that the only amount that she would then need to spend down would be the value of the life estate, which the kids had just given her.
Right.
And that's accurate. But then by having given the kids the life estate, now the kids own the entire property, which means when Mary dies, there's no step up in the tax basis of that property. Because when you make a gift of property, of appreciated property, then with what you give, okay, so his taxes 101, and by the way, we're just going to talk for a couple more minutes because we started a little late. This is taxes 101. So when you own a piece of property, something that has appreciated in value, and you've owned it for at least a year, when you go to sell it, you're going to pay a capital gains tax on a capital gain. What is the capital gain? It's the difference between sale price and basis. What is basis? Usually it's the purchase price. So, but if you give away a piece of property to somebody else, like in this case, giving it to your kids, you're giving them your basis. So if Frank and Mary bought their house on Martha's Vineyard for $50,000 40 years ago, right, and it's now worth $500,000, if they gift it to the kids get that basis, the $50,000 basis.
They don't get the value at the time of the gift?
Nope. They get the base. That's the basis. If, on the other hand, Mary has given away the remainder interest but kept the life estate, upon her death, for tax purposes, the basis jumps to the date of death value.
Right.
And suddenly you eliminate the capital gains tax, which is big, right? It's more significant here than in most places, more significant here than any place except Nantucket, where the values have really gone up. But it's a huge number. So that's the main reason why you keep the life estate. Well, there are two reasons. One, so you don't get thrown out, but the other, so that your kids don't have to pay the capital gains tax.
Yes.
Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
If you determine that at some point you would like home care, stay at home care, mm-hmm. has there been a figure, or is there any way to figure, that'll cost approximately, even with prices going up, so much a month to stay at home?
Question is, how much does it cost in home care to stay at home right now? Number I've heard here is $25 to $30 an hour from an agency, right? And that's kind of broad numbers, right? But you want to shop that? You want to shop it. Okay. So it depends on the number, typically by the hour, unless you're using SOSTEC. SOSTEC is basically an employment agency that will connect you with a person who will live in your house, and then SOSTEC will kind of help you do the numbers, but they don't have any responsibilities to you. You're not hiring SOSTEC, you're hiring that person. It is my understanding that cost tends to run $70,000 to $80,000 a year. Yeah, that order of magnitude. And it's pricey. It's pricey. I mean, when you think about it, the reason nursing homes are cheaper than staying at home. And the reason is because you've got less staff dealing with more people. To have somebody 24 hours in your house is an expensive proposition. Any other questions? If not, thank you very much for your time. I really appreciate it. I'm glad to take any other questions afterwards. And I'll see you in a couple of months if you want to hear Benefits 10 or Elder Law 102, which is going to be Benefits 101. Thank you very much.